speech, my voice is not actually euphonious. I had an operation on my voice box that didn't really work very well. And I also have always stuttered. But as I get older, I get more voluble. I'm in a profession where you have to talk all the time. I'm a teacher. So it's a free country. If you can't stand my tone of voice or my stutter or something, you can run screaming from the room. I won't mind. I'll be okay. The main question in economics is as Adam Smith said, the nature and causes of the wealth of nations. How is it that we earn our little livings? And how is it that the livings which we earn in very many countries, and increasingly in once very, very poor countries like China and India, has grown so amazingly in the last couple of centuries? In a way, that's the central question in economics. And it's certainly the central question in the debate between socialism and what is unfortunately called capitalism. Because if socialism or capitalism don't deliver the goods in terms of adequate health care, higher education, opportunities for vacations in Lubbock. the economy hasn't done its job, at least by modern standards. Up to 1800, no one expected very much. Up to 1800, the average human on the planet, with very few exceptions, I mean a few lords and priests and emperors and so on, were living high on the hog, but most people were down around $2 or $3 a day in real income. Now this is corrected for inflation, this hasn't anything to do with money or anything like that. It's real income, $2 or $3 a day. Whereas in the United States, the average income nowadays for every man, woman, child, income and consumption and earnings, if you had any economics, you know, those are all the same, is $130 a day. So you go from $2 or $3 a day in 1800, most of the world, in fact, essentially all the world. There are a few sort of standouts in 1800, the Dutch, the English North Americans may have had a little bit higher, $4 a day. Imagine trying to live on $4 a day. Now, it's not hard to imagine in a way, because there are great many countries in the world where that's still true, where it's $2 or $3 a day. Let's take Afghanistan. I was speaking last night to some guys who served in the army in Afghanistan. They agreed with me that that's about the standard. They're very, very poor. So how did it happen, this change? It's completely transformed our lives. I look around at this audience. Let's see now. I don't see any Habsburg chins. I don't see any descendants of crowned heads of Europe or Africa or Asia. Are there any descendants of royal families here? I'm Irish, so of course I'm descended from an Irish king. But there were about 100 Irish kings, so it was not a very select group. Now, we're all descended from exceptionally poor and miserable peasants, or occasionally urban proletariat. In this audience, ask yourself, how far back do you have to go before your people are farmers? And then how far back you have to go to the old countries, various old countries, before they're really farmers? They're not on $200,000 air-conditioned harvesters, but they're hoeing away, scratching away the soil. In my case, on my Norwegian side, it's my great-grandfather who came here from Norway in the 1880s, when all the other Scandinavians were starving. All right, so that's the thing to be explained. Now there's another feature of this change that capitalism wrought, that happened when we committed ourselves to free markets and free minds. And that is the spiritual change. And that's a big question. Because I think most of us, if we thought that participation in a market economy was really corrupting, we would feel it wasn't worth it. Who cares if we have Mercedes sports car? What kind is it?
Porsche.
He likes secondhand sports cars. He's too cheap to buy the first one. He's okay on the secondhand. He's got a secondhand Porsche. Who cares if you have a second hand Porsche if you corrupt your immortal soul? As it says in the Bible, what does it matter if you gain the world but lose your soul? Well, so those are really the two questions. What caused this amazing increase in income? In a way, let's put it this way, the second most important secular event in human history. Probably most important was the domestication of plants and animals, which happened in 9 different places in the world, in South America, Peru, in New Guinea, sub-Saharan Africa, a couple of places in the Midwest, Mid-East, Midwest, all of it, maybe Midwest, and in the Eastern Asia. Around, 8,000 BC, 6,000, the horse wasn't domesticated until about 4,000 BC in the areas above the Black Sea. So that's probably the most important event, although in a way, not. Because the scope in an agricultural society for the ordinary peasants, subject, as my friend Mansur Olson once put it, to the stationary bandits, it's a nice phrase, the stationary bandits of the lord or the priest who took most of your crop or learned half of it, and you were left with the crumbs. So that kind of existence in a traditional society, agricultural society, that we're very liable to romanticize, very liable to say, oh, closed corporate peasant community, how lovely, dancing around the maypole. How sweet, isn't it charming that they're all illiterate and die at 30? Well, it's not so charming. It's nasty, it's confining. It's nothing like the scope of your lives, the opportunities that everyone in this room has to explore, to think, to dance, to sing. These are cut off in an extremely poor society of the sort that even the agricultural revolution left us with. I mentioned my Norwegian ancestors. What happened is that their diet depended increasingly on potatoes, and the potatoes kept failing. It's not just the Irish who had a famine in the late 1840s, it's also Scandinavia and So it's not that we've left a wonderful world of traditional society. I think we've got to stop this romance with the past. Now, I love the past. I'm a historian. I like dead people. I love dead people. The deader, the better. And I love to study them and find out about what was going on and so forth. But we can't express it this way. All the pessimistic books that sell much better than my books sell, alas, all the pessimistic books that say the sky is falling, the sky is falling, things are going to hell. After me, the flood, after me, the deluge. Oh, woe is me. That's all nonsense. We're right now is the best time in human history. People sometimes speculate, what would they like to be if they could go back in history? Well, I'd like to be a combination of Cleopatra and Elizabeth I. But actually, Cleopatra didn't turn out so well. And neither did Elizabeth I, although glorious in many ways. Her life was kind of scary. She had all these suitors, Catholic suitors, that she kept putting off. Actually, it sounds kind of fun, Elizabeth. But in any case, the ordinary person in past times was miserable, utterly miserable. All right. So the answer to all this, I possess law. I have solved the basic problem in economics. Right here. The problem is capitalism good virtues? And is it the source of our wealth? And how exactly? All my colleagues in economics, I said, sorry to say, very much, but they're all wrong. They're all mistaken, whether they're from the left or the right, or the middle. The history of since Adam Smith, the attempts to answer this question of the nature of causes of wealth for nations have been busts from a scientific point of view. And in these books, which you may acquire, on Amazon.com, cheap, inexpensive, answer it. The first is called, published in 2006 by the University of Chicago Press, called The Bourgeois Virtues, Ethics for an Age of Commerce. And there I confront this fundamental ethical question about capitalism. Is it corroding of the human soul? Well, one answer you can give is yes, but so are all those other systems we have tried from time to time. Right? Socialism encourages envy, as we've seen in the fall of social societies in Eastern Europe, and it encourages a lack of respect for the rule of law. Because to follow the rule of law is being impoverished in the socialist society on the whole. Take a look at Venezuela right now. Certainly, an aristocratic society or a Christian society, a theocracy of a Christian character or of a Muslim character, have encouraged their own vices, their own unique vices. So it's not at all obvious that a commercial society of the sort we have is just instantly corrupting. A lot of what I call the clerisy, the intellectuals, the journalists, the artists, feel this way. They feel, especially after German Romanticism, they feel superior to you all. And you people are not great artists. I'm Picasso. I am great, so you're dope. That's kind of the attitude of the clerisy. And in particular, their attitude is hostile to capitalism on the whole. It's a rare novice in the modern world in the last 2 centuries. Willa Cather comes to mind, a wonderful novelist, you must read Cather. But there are very few who, like her, admire a life of being a commercial farmer or open hardware store in town or inventing a new machine. Mostly the clerisy are scornful. So that's what that was about. The ethical question. I came at it with an approach to ethics called virtue ethics. Sounds like a redundancy. But it's not, because most other philosophical approaches to ethics are utilitarian or Kantian or contractarian. And I said, no, that's not the right way to go. You have to talk about the individual virtues. Faith, hope, love. The greatest of these is love. Prudence, temperance. Justice and courage. So that's that. Then I realized, this is 2006, then I started to realize, as I finished up this book, actually with about walking pneumonia as I was doing the index. So don't depend on the index in this book. I keep trying to find things and I can't find anything. But I started to realize that this ethics that I was talking about, this ethics of capitalism, which sounds like a contradiction in terms, but it's not, I'd say, may have something to do with the material success of capitalism. First of all, it's spiritual success, or at least not an ethical catastrophe necessarily. The second book, No Insight. Maybe ethics, rhetoric, ideas, how we talk to each other, how we treat each other, maybe that changes the economy. Maybe the economy is not just about supply and demand curves entirely. Maybe it's not just about prices and quantities only. Now look, I'm an economist. I haven't got those shoes on. I was going to say my patent shoes. But I'm an economist. I love the field. I admire it. Lots of my friends are economists. Shocking. There they are. But I don't believe, and found in this book, that the usual explanations of economics for how we got so rich, going from $3 to $130, are correct. So it's the second one is called Bourgeois Dignity. Subtitle, I always put the punch in subtitles. Why economics can't explain the modern world. And there are two broad categories of explanations of why we got so rich. One is essentially a left-wing, socialist explanation, and the other is a conservative, rich-friendly version of explanation. And the first says that we're rich because we exploit other people. Marx himself, the hero of my youth, I was once a Marxist, said that the employment relationship is intrinsically exploitative. The other Marx, some of the older people who know who I'm talking about, Groucho Marx, the great American film and vaudeville comedian of the 1920s, 30s, was not a Marxist, except in many sense, and a communist friend of his, George, came to him at the height of Groucho's success in film in the 1930s, and so his friend was a communist, George was a member of the Communist Party, And Groucho had a very cool sense of humor and said, "Well, Groucho, I lost my job. I desperately need a job. Can you find a job for me in Hollywood? You're very influential." And Groucho said, "No, George, I'm sorry, I can't do it. I don't want to exploit you." So that's the basic story of life. That trade is exploited, it's unfair. This has had a terrible effect on economic policy in Latin America, for example, over the last half century or so.
All right.
And so the argument is that we became rich because we sold from, say, slaves. That's it. There's a new movement in American history to attribute American wealth to this basic sin, and regarded as a sin, of slavery. There are all kinds of historical problems with this argument that if you have slaves and you get rich, well, the slave trade across the Atlantic, a terrible, horrible event, was matched by a slave trade up East Africa. Actually, it lasted longer than the slave trade across the Atlantic. It lasted for 300 or 400 years, actually more than that, more like 500 or 600 years. And slaves were being seized in what's now East Africa, and being dragged up to once Constantinople and then Istanbul and sold in slave markets. Yet the Middle East didn't develop economically. If all you need to do is to sell slaves, hey, cool. Let's, not really, but let's get a bunch of slaves and we'll be rich. Well, it didn't work out that way in most societies. There have been many slave societies. Everyone here is the descendant of a slave. I told you about my Norwegian background, but you can tell from my name that I'm half Irish. I've got a problem. Undoubtedly, my Norwegian Viking ancestors made a special in coming to Ireland, enslaved some of my Irish ancestors. To whom do I apply for reparations? The Irish or the Norwegians? They're both rich now, so it's a serious problem. So, and then you could say, as the left does, well, it's not so much the slaves, it's the English working class. Or the North American working class. They're the ones who are exploited. That's why we're rich. Now, understand that's a kind of strange argument, because it says, if we enslave half of this room, the whole room will get richer. What? I thought the idea was to steal from this half and give to that half. And then on average, there wouldn't be any gain. But no, they said, oh, no. Somehow, mysteriously, this allowed the accumulation of capital, as you put it, and this left for the working class, and then that was invested and made us all rich. So there's some curious ethics here. It's very strange that partial slavery can make other people rich for partial exploitation. And nowadays, you hear a lot about imperialism. And your students here have told this in all their classes, and the people out of college have heard it endlessly when they went to college or went to high school. You heard it over and over again that we're rich in Europe and its offshoots like Texas, the Republic of Texas, I should say, because the third world is being exploited. The India, the jewel of the empire, of the British Empire, made the British rich and stole from the Africans, Indians, whoever they could steal from. And that doesn't make any more sense than the slavery argument. It's too small for one thing. The amount of stealing that went on in the British Empire was trivial. In the 18th century, the 1700s, there was going to be a stealing. But even that was small potatoes by comparison with the size of British incomes, very tiny. So it can't be that it's the Indian Empire or the earlier empire where it was the United States that was the victim, so to speak. That can't be, it's not right. Empire, no more than stealing from other poor people. Empire is not a good business plan. That doesn't mean that empire was good for people who were imperialized. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying it wasn't good for the ordinary people back home. Extreme example is Leopold II of Belgium, who owned Congo, what's now Congo, the Republic of Congo, outright as his little estate. It wasn't owned by the Belgian government. It was owned by King Leopold II. By the way, it was a cousin of Queen Victoria. All right. Well, how did that affect the Belgians? Not at all. King Leopold, when rubber became an important commodity with the invention of the bicycle, sent people into the forest to tap trees to get natural rubber. He chopped off hundreds of thousands of hands as punishment if he didn't do it. And what was the result? Castles in France for King Leopold. Not a sou for the ordinary Belgian. Ordinary Belgians became relatively rich by 19th century standards by being good at making steel. Among their specialties. And that required ingenuity, invention, human creativity. It was not about these material causes. You're seeing the tendency here. These material causes that economists emphasize. Foreign trade is a good thing. Donald Trump is a fool to attack it. But foreign trade doesn't make countries massive. Makes them better off. Look, I have to turn in my economist union card if I say something other. But it's not going to explain 3,000% increase in income. 3,000%, that's what we're talking about since 1800. You go from 3 to 130, that's more than a factor of 30. It's more like a factor of, what is it, 40. But in any case, it's enormous. And foreign trade, little changes in allocation, change the tax system a little bit. They're good, they're not to be the same, but they're not epoch making. So what is? What's epoch making is human ingenuity, is novelties, is new ideas. Ideas, some of them technological, like electric lights, was very attractive, inexpensive steel, we see all around us, reinforced concrete, which is a miraculous material. I was driving through Dallas this morning, being driven through Dallas, and I was marveling at the overpasses, you know how it is in those spaghetti junctions. Overpasses, and they're all made with concrete, which is a Roman technology, and was known in China as well, with steel. Steel becomes cheap in the 1860s and 70s, and Andrew Carnegie was one of the makers of cheap steel. Pre-stressed, very strong, you can do amazing things with. And then some of the innovations were merely organizational. The Autobahn, known to us as superhighways, was an idea in the 1920s in Germany. I don't know who thought it up. And then it was implemented in the 1930s by Hitler. And the Autobahn is not a technological innovation. It's not some new machine. It just, let's see, maybe things will be better if we have limited access highways. this is, and a spectacular example is containerization. Some guy who ran a trucking firm in North Carolina, 1956, thought, now wait a second, suppose we take this seal that we got, we make boxes of a standard size, and then we put them on trucks, and then we take them to the port and put them on ships, and then we don't have any sealing by the longshoremen. We don't have any, boxes falling off the back of a truck, so to speak. Everything's sealed in this box, and it goes straight to China. And then comes back to Long Beach, comes by train to here, or by a truck. That's a brilliant idea. There's nothing scientific about it. You don't need to have a degree in physics or engineering to think up and actually implement containerization. But it has enormously dropped the price of transport, ocean transport. There's a silly idea that the Chinese government has to build, what's it called, the Great Road or something, of trains between China and Europe. This is local. This is insane. One big Panama freighter can carry 8,000 containers. Now think how many 100-car trains, 8,000 containers, is the equivalent of. One container per car. 100 cars is a long train. Think of how many tracks you'd have to have between, Mongolia and Turkey to make that run. It's a silly idea. So, ideas were tried out. If they didn't work and didn't have the support of a permanent government, they flourished. And the ideas could be just as simple as, I think it'd be a good idea to have a hairdressing salon in my neighborhood, and I'm allowed to do it. I'm permitted to do it. There's no hairdressing monopoly stopping me from doing it. A monopoly is supported by the government. And in an ideal world, there wouldn't be certification of hairdressers. Anyone who thought they could do hairdressing could try it out. And if they screw up enough hair, then they go out of business. So that's how it worked. That's what made us rich, is this kind of innovation. Now then you have to ask, as I do, and what about the second volume is, I go through all the usual explanations, and I show them to be completely inadequate. For example, coal. People say, the Industrial Revolution was caused by coal, and this great enrichment that McCluskey talks about is just a continuation of coal. Coal. Think about it. Coal. God. Well, turns out that China had coal and was using it for industrial purposes 3,000 years before the modern Europeans cottoned onto it. So there's something dramatically wrong with the whole coal story. And I have a little chapter called Not Even Coal. So that's what this is all about. Number three faces up to the problem then. Where did the innovation come from? It didn't come from piling up capital, even human capital. Piling up capital is necessary. You have to build the auditorium. So it's necessary. But if you just pour capital into a local economy or a national economy or a world economy, and you haven't got any new ideas, you're just doing what you've always done, you're not accomplishing anything. by the way, relevant to lots of other things. The modern symphony orchestra is an invention of that era around 1800. Suddenly, music is being bought, not by the aristocracy of the church, but by the middle class, by the bourgeoisie. And the great concert halls of Europe all date from the early 19th century. So you have large Beethoven-sized orchestras for the first time. And that's the kind of new idea, the idea for the saxophone, to take a mechanical example, or the improvements in the invention, and then the great improvements in the piano. It starts out as a kind of a crappy little instrument that hammers away at the strings, and then they get it better and better until we have modern pianos. That's just one of thousands of examples of ingenuity that come after 1800. Well, okay. Why? Why just and only then? Why is this factor of 20 or 30 confined to the last two centuries? Whereas before there might be outbursts like the invention of the oil and wheat economy in Eastern Mediterranean around 700 BCE. Yeah, maybe that doubled income. That's an increase of 100%. Nice to have, I'm not saying it's bad, but it's not 3,000%. It's not even 2,000%. It's only 100%. What we're trying to explain is this enormously larger increase. The Song dynasty in the early centuries of the second millennium CE is nice, maybe double Chinese per capita income in real terms, but didn't have any permanent effect. Fell back, these countries, one after another, after their spurt, fell back to $3 a day. But it didn't happen to us. It didn't happen to Northwestern Europe, which is where it started. First in Holland, then in England, Scotland, the North American colonies, then Northern France, the Rhineland, eventually Sweden. This was Northwestern Europe where it started. And it resulted in this enormous increase, which I call the Great Enrichment. It's not the Industrial Revolution that's important. That kind of thing had happened before. As I said, it reverted back to low incomes. But this last time, look around you, it stayed. Half the people in this room would be dead if we had the medicine of 1800. Most of you would be brutally malnourished as children if we had the economy of 1800. Most of you would be illiterate if we had the economy of 1800. So why? Well, my answer is a surprising word: liberalism. Not the way the word is defined in the United States nowadays, where anyone on the left is a liberal. That's crazy. That's just to call people liberals and slow socialists. Bernie Sanders is not a liberal. Bernie Sanders is a socialist. He's a nice guy. He probably, when he went to college, he's about my age. Bernie Sanders and I probably had exactly the same opinions back in 1960. I was a socialist, he was a socialist. It's just that I've gotten over it. All right. So what I mean by liberal is what the blessed Adam Smith said. He said that what we should adopt, now hear this, is the liberal plan. Equality, liberty, and justice. The plan of equality, liberty, and justice. But and by what he meant by equality is not what Rousseau meant, or not what Bernie Sanders means. He meant equal dignity. Adam Smith was a social egalitarian. He didn't scorn the poor. He wasn't the country club, the Republican, to be frank. Okay, then liberty was the liberty to open your addresses when and where you want. In Tennessee, right now, to open a moving company, two guys in a truck, this is quite a miracle. You have to get the permission of the existing moving companies. Now ask yourself, you're an existing moving company, and some jerk proposes to take away some of your business by opening a moving company. And he comes hat in hand to ask permission. Do it. What are you going to say? Unless you're an unusual liberal, you're going to say, no way, Jose, go back. You're not going to have a moving company in Tennessee. So that's what he means by liberty. And then by justice, he means equality before the law. So observe. Liberalism developed really theoretically in the 18th century, 1700s, by bunch of intellectuals like Voltaire and Mary Wollstonecraft and Tom Paine and so forth, and Adam Smith, is just an intellectual movement mainly. The man who wrote, all men are created equal and are endowed by their creator with certain inalienable rights, was a slave owner. He was a slave owner who didn't even free his own son by selling him. So we don't instantly move to a perfectly liberal society in the United States or anywhere else. It's a slow process of freeing one group after another. Poor free men, black slaves, women, gays, transgender people, for Christ's sake. I don't mean to take vain, because it's not in vain, it's celebration. So there's this gradual freeing. The young are free in the modern world. I grew up in the 1960s, I was young then. And that's the great decade of colonial people being free and of young people being freed from domination by their parents. And it was another reiteration of the gradual freeing of half the population called women. So that was, now why is that connected to this economic growth, this amazing ingenuity, this amazing intelligence? Well, when you're free, you're ingenious. When you're free, you're willing to take a chance. When you're free, you're allowed to. You can, as the English say, you can have a go. They're very sports-oriented, but this is, you know, I've had my batting time at cricket. I'm a big cricket fan, by the way. So you're allowed to have a go, have your turn at batting. And that's the core egalitarian idea in liberalism. Let you all have a go. I speak of the bourgeois deal. By the bourgeois, I just mean middle class, and an ingenious poor person of that side that makes money and moves into the middle class, or people go to university like all you are doing, move into the middle class. But in any case, here's my formula. It's going to be the title of a popular book that a colleague of mine and I are composing. The bourgeois deal. The middle class, you let me, mon bourgeois, have a go. Let me try out the hairdressing salon, start, I don't know, invent something, and I'll make you rich. You let me innovate, and I'll make you rich. And that's what happened. In the first instance, the person who makes the invention does well. But there's been a calculation by an excellent economist that since the war in the United States, only 2% of the gains from innovation go to the innovators. The rest goes to us. Sam Walton of Walmart innovated by taking early advantage of barcodes to control inventory. That was his central idea. And he became, he and his brother became fabulously rich, and they sired children who are fabulously idiotic. I have a friend who knows them personally. They're just a bunch of rich people. There's dumb as posts. But anyway, they made a lot of money. But at the 2% versus 98%, I'm willing to make that deal. We get the 98%. These nitwitted Walton children get the rest. Okay, that's okay. And anyway, after a few generations, it dissipates. Andrew Carnegie in 1901 was the richest person in the world, making steel. He had been a poor weaver's son from Scotland. You've never heard of Carnegie after Andrew. That's because he gave it all away. I found, age 15, the socialist anarchist classic by Prince Kropotkin, Mutual Aid, which is still a wonderful book to read, although economically a little dubious, in a Carnegie library that Andrew Carnegie had in fact financed. He financed about 4,000 libraries, public libraries, in the United States. And I think that's a wonderful paradox, that I became a socialist because of Andrew Carnegie. So then where does liberalism come from? Because it could have come to China. 1492, if you had known there was going to be a great enrichment a few centuries later, you would bet the farm on China. Because China had the rule of law, it had excellent markets, it had the very best science in the world, the very best engineering. It had foreign trade up the kazoo. It was really a prosperous economy by historical standards, a prosperous and sophisticated economy. But it didn't grow. So what happened, I claim, again in volume three, you know, notice volume three is very thick. Well, that's because I was going to do four volumes, not three. And so I had to cram everything into the last volume. And I decided, look, a trilogy might be considered somewhat self-indulgent, but a tetralogy is an abomination. I should be stoned to death for doing four volumes, so I didn't want to get stoned to death, so I only did three. But the other part of that book is to explain where liberalism came from. I say it came from certain accidents of European politics and society from the early 16th century on. First one was the Protestant Reformation, but the effect was not what the great German sociologist Max Weber wrote in 1905 in his great book, Protestant Ethic and Spirit of Capitalism, one of the great books in the history of the world. Wonderful book, but wrong. As science often is. Most scientific propositions that we believe in now in a couple of hundred years will be shown to be inadequate and they have to be supplemented. He said it was a psychological change inside the middle class that these bourgeois people, these merchants and manufacturers, suddenly got religion, in particular Calvinist religion, and they reckoned the only way to show that they were among the chosen was to be successful in business. And this is a lot of hooey. It's been shown that's a technical word in theology and economic history, hooey. The theologians, the church historians have shown that it's ridiculous. And the economic historians and economists have shown that it's economics is ridiculous. No. What happened was, in the Protestant, in the radical Protestant Reformation, not the magisterial Reformation of my Anglicans, I'm an Anglican, or Lutherans, where the minister was still chosen, the priest was still chosen by a hierarchy. So they didn't have a pope, but they had bishops. We have, and we Episcopalians. But the radicals, the Anabaptists, the well-named Congregationalists, chose their own ministers. That's what Congregationalism means. More, even more radical example are the Quakers, the Society of Friends, where they don't have any minister at all. We could turn this meeting into a Quaker meeting right now. We could stop talking. We can wait until the service ends. I've been to a number of Quaker meetings. They're very impressive. So that's the point. Yeah. That's the point. There's a, what can I say? In the Protestant Reformation, people take charge of their religious lives. And I would claim, research it, it's probably true. I think it's true. They thought they could take control of their economic lives too. And there were a number of other accidents. The English Revolution, 1640s. The Dutch Revolt against Spain, which went on for 80 years. The Glorious Revolution in England at the end of the 17th century. The American Revolution, the French Revolution. All of them made people bold. And that caused innovation. This is a researchable topic. If you have a PhD students here, you can make your fortune this way by showing them to be true or false. So that's my story. We got rich by being free. It's good to be free, I think, as a liberal, I'm a liberal. But it's also enriching to be free. So go forth. Abandon your socialist ideas and come to Jesus to Adam Smith. Thank you very much.